along my journey, a lot of things have happened, a lot of failures, a lot of exploration, a lot of discovery. But the one thing that I have learned is that I am part of what we call the creative class. The creative class is a collection of people, a collection of mindsets, a collection of ideas that encourage each and every one of you to participate in the new economy. So for me, it looks like this. There's this us versus them scenario that happens in creative organizations. Us can simply be defined as design. The weird people in the room that dress funny, have tattoos, ear piercings, play loud music, eat food at random times at night, produce weird smells, often which are followed by weird noises, which are often followed by weird solutions and ideas. And essentially, when we show up in the building, normally people don't understand what we do because we aren't trained in design school to have a shared lexicon with our peers. It's a false phenomenon that happens in design school. We sit with other artists. We sit with other creatives. We sit with people just like us, and we communicate only with people like us. That causes us to have a false sense of confidence, a false sense of awareness, that the rest of the world understands who we are and how we behave. And then there's them, the managers, the people that tell us no, the people that say, you don't have the budget, which equals you don't have the love, which is true often. But essentially, the managers are wondering, what is the true value of design? Is it something that I can participate in? Is it something that I could leverage? Is it something that actually is beneficial for me? Or is this something that I should just ignore and use as a service? Can we call them in when we need the presentations to look beautiful? Can we call them in when we need the room to feel amazing and comfortable and cool and vibrant? Can we call the creative people when we need to look youthful and consumer relevant? But essentially, what that means is that it has to be a fundamental shift where the us and the them come together. And I'm a living example of that. I spent 14 years at Nike. I started off as one of the first design interns, so it's wonderful to hear the work that Phil is doing over at IBM because internships are critical pathways for future executives, future leaders. And I started as a person that designed lace tips, which is the least desirable portion of a shoe. Trust me. Trust me when I tell you no one cares that you design lace tips. I went back home to Chicago. I tried to impress my friends, and it failed miserably. I pointed out every lace tip and tried to claim that it was mine, and unfortunately it wasn't. Someone else was tasked with that same job. But what I discovered is that by being in the room and doing the small things very well, it measured up to big success because design in and of itself are very small victories that equal one strategic outcome. And along that journey, I allowed curiosity to fuel me. And it led me to Stanford Business School because the CEO at the time was Phil Knight, the founder of Nike. And I asked so many questions in business meetings that eventually he said, you know what, you need to go to business school to find the answers because I simply do not have the time to answer every single question that you have. But it led me to understand something. It led me to understand that there are ways to measure the impact of design in a corporation. And it also led a woman by the name of Janine Ray to write a blog post in 2014 that covers this very topic. She looked at 15 design-centric companies, and she discovered some very important things that led to the creation of what's called the Design Value Index. And essentially, there are a few criteria. They have to be publicly traded companies in the US for 10 plus years, so some substantial success, meaningful success. They had to deploy design as an integrated function. So design had to report to the CEO. It couldn't be the service of the weird people in the corner that made the noises and made the weird smells. Increasing design investment and influence. So that meant the facilities. It meant the processes. It meant the protocol. It meant the recruitment. It meant the scalability of design. It also meant a clear reporting structure and operational model. Design used to report into engineering. It used to report into marketing. It used to report into these weird craft services departments that would only show up when you needed presentations done. But now design reports directly to the CEO. It has a function in and of itself. So it has an accountability matrix. Design now uses RACI models, which is really interesting when you think about who's responsible, who's accountable, who supports, who consults, and who needs to be informed about the design process. Experienced design executives at the helm, directing the activity. So someone who came from the culture, someone who understands the language and the nuances, the intricacies of what it means to actually create a product. And last, tangible senior level executive commitment to design. Commitment is a key word when you talk about designers. We're very fragile, sensitive people, so we need to know, do you care about us? Trust me. We need to know that the senior executives actually care. So when she actually did this research, she found that by placing a $10,000 investment, looked at over a 10-year period, it was a 228% yield comparative to other companies on the S&P. So that's extremely interesting. So for the people in the room who love to see graphs and numbers, I have it. And as you all know, as business leaders, up means good, right? So you can see, design index, it went up. Simply put, there are three conditions that I've discovered that I believe allow these companies to succeed. And we'll talk about them, right? And I look at it through the lens of an equation. C plus R equals R. C meaning culture. How do you facilitate creativity? How do you scale curiosity? How do you sustain excellence? How do you sustain momentum towards a single focus goal? The second one, relevance. These are narratives. This is the way that you integrate your business into society. This is the way that you connect with human behavior. Stories are the fuel of our existence. Stories are what are carried on beyond our brand. Stories are what are carried on beyond our tenure as executives. So what people say about you when you're not in the room is more important than what they say to you when you're in the room. So how do you use narrative as a key tool for engagement? Last piece, the magical word, which is return. It's a return on investment, return on your actions, return consumers. So this whole notion of that this is a cyclical process. Where you start is where you end, and where you end is where you begin again. So culture. Culture for us and how we define it at Mark One is about radical collaboration and team formation. And so we use this quote from Carl Sagan that talks about the beauty of living things is not the atoms that go into it, but the way that those atoms are arranged. So it's interesting when you hear about all the different various nuances of a business, finance, strategy, legal, design, marketing. Those things function well when they're put together in a way that is purposeful and meaningful. When there's a strategy, there's a vision. And that's essentially what we do at Mark One. We have a process that allows us to get after products like this called the Vessel. So for 14 years, I focused on activity tracking, designing for the world's greatest athletes, pushing the boundaries of human potential through the lens of athletics. And I took that idea and I took that energy and we translated it into consumption behavior. So our equation at Mark One is A plus C equals B. Activity tracking plus consumption awareness equals true behavior change. So with this product, the Vessel, we've created something that can only be done in the eyes of a consumer in a laboratory. We've done automated nutrient tracking in the form of a ubiquitous object, which is a cup. And on that cup, you get nutritional information that allows you to make proper decisions in real time. So for the first time in history, people who have food allergies and intolerances, people who truly want to track their hydration needs can know exactly what do you need, because the myth of 8 cups a day is false. It's extremely false. And it's a myriad of problems that come from lack of hydration. And so we're really trying to engage the consumer in a new way. We're trying to give you more information than you've ever had before. But in order to do this, we needed to create a new flying formation for our business. And that flying formation looks like this. It's a very nuanced process where we work in what we call triads. It's a marketer, it's a designer, and it's an engineer. And they collectively go out and they find insights. Those insights move into ideation phase. And this is where the process really shifts for the design creation cycle. We have them present business cases. What is the viability of this opportunity? Is it founded on insights? Is it a true need that you discovered? And show us the return on this investment. So no longer is it a bunch of sketches and great ideas and things that could work. We want to empower every single person to come from their discipline, collectively work together to provide insights and actions that we can bet on, that we can feel good about, that we can believe in from the onset. And from there, we move into the proof of concept. And then beyond, we do the experience build, and then we experience test, we launch, and then we go into sustain mode. So right now, in the middle, we're in that process right now with this product. We're in what we call our go-to-market phase, which I'm sure you're all familiar with. So this is a new way of us working together with these multiple disciplines that goes back to my very first comment where we said designers are put in situations where we are only taught to communicate with one another. So now we're teaching them to have a shared lexicon, aligned against a single vision. And so how do we do that? Well, in our culture, we have 5 areas of distinction that allow us to be different. It's insights, storytelling, innovation, aesthetics, and craftsmanship. These are the core pillars of brands of distinction, not just brands of differentiation, but brands of distinction. Brands that have a unique view on the world, a very prominent view on the world, and an esteemed brand that allows them to show up and not only create wonder and delight, but sustain that wonder and delight for many product generations to come. And so it all comes down to positioning. This is how you show up in the market. And when you look at insights, it's about what we do, how we do it, why do we do it, what are the consumers actually looking for, how do we serve them, how do we know them, how do we engage them in ways that they never thought we could engage them. It's about storytelling. How do we connect to basic human behavior? How do we take them back to that moment when they were in the 5th grade and everything was possible? How can we take them back to the moment where they saw Star Wars for the first time and they look at the prime line on the vessel and think that it's a lightsaber and say, I can never believe that this could happen. I'm actually drinking from a Star Wars cup. I'm a Jedi Knight. That's exactly how I felt the first time I saw it. I still feel like that. When you multiply that and you add on these 3 layers, you start to think about your products. So your positioning is unique. It's distinct. It feels right for your consumer. It feels right for your market segment. But then it shows up in your products. in your innovations, in your aesthetic, in your craftsmanship. People often look at color as something as decorative. Color is one of the most core signifiers of a differentiation strategy. Color can denote function. Color can denote value. So when you think about the word aesthetics, it's often talked about how do you make something beautiful. In design, what we focus on is how aesthetics show up in the form of function. How do you make something purposeful? How do you make something valuable and memorable? So we use aesthetics as a core differentiator for our products. It serves a purpose. Colors, textures, fonts, it serves a purpose. It reinforces that narrative. And then when you have a product that's finished with handcrafted elements, a product that feels human, it feels simple, it feels elegant and understandable, that's when you create the engagement that goes deeper than just a product, service, or experience. It becomes part of your life. It becomes something that recedes. Good technology should recede. And people should just be able to exist within the ecosystem of the products that they buy. The second piece is the relevance. Insights enhance narratives that build consumer loyalty and brand identity. At Nike, we had a tremendous advantage because we have a marketing machine that the world can't really argue with, and it's called sports. At some point in time, if you weren't an athlete, you've known an athlete. If you didn't like sports and you didn't watch it, you probably were told about what happened between UK and Ireland this last week. And we know what turned out to happen for the UK team. Ireland, of course, destroyed them, which I'm happy about because I'm in Ireland, not in the UK right now. So I'm always on the side of the winner. That's my goal in life. And so for us, we talked about listening to the voice of the athlete. I was telling a story earlier that when I first started at Nike, they recruited people who were former athletes or people who had a passion and affinity for athletics because the design process didn't start with a sketch. It started with a workout. I would literally go and take batting practice with people like Derek Jeter or go and shoot shots with Michael Jordan or get in the ring with an Olympic boxer at the time who was a professional boxer, Roy Jones. The pain that they felt was the pain that I felt. The journey that they took was the journey that I took. So when I sat down to sketch a shoe, I wasn't drawing a shoe for a person that I heard about. I was drawing a shoe for a person that I actually got to know. So I was thinking about the intricacies of the motivation. How did they actually perform that sport? How did they sustain this level of energy to compete with the world's best with no fear? So this built a different connection. So when you listen to the voice of your consumers, it's beyond serving them. It's getting to a place of wonder and delight in a way that you can never imagine. And this is what we talk about at Nike a lot, know me to serve me. The word serve, when put out of context, can be a very negative word. But when you think about your consumer base, you think about your employees, you think about the people that will work for your company someday, you have to know them to serve them. So it's beyond empathy and understanding. It's about mirroring their behaviors. It's about being part of their daily life. It's about being integrated into a single tribe that is aligned once again against that single focus goal, that single focus mission. So a good example of this shows up in a video that I'm going to show next. And it talks about high school football and how that created momentum in the marketplace for Nike.
Hope for people in my community, and I just want to be that special one who shows other individuals that flowers do grow from concrete.
I think about going out, I think about partying and having fun, I think about my family back in my mind. They really need me to make it, so I have no choice.
You're in the center of attention, and you know everybody's waiting on you to make some type of big play. Whether you had a good game or not, they're going to talk about it at the end of the night.
When I work out, I always think about somebody being better than me. So I always do my best for that not to happen.
From home, he got a little bit of either you're all in and you do it right or don't bother doing it.
This is your night. This is your time.
This is your moment. And every single minute you spend trying to hold on to it because you may never get it again.
Till the roof comes off, till the lights go out. Till my leg give out, can't shut my mouth. Till the smoke clears out, and my high turn out. I'ma rip this till my bone pull out. Till the roof comes on, till the lights go out. Till my leg give out, can't shut my mouth. Till the smoke clears out, and my high turn out. I'ma rip this till my bone pull out.
Until the roof comes on, the roof comes on. Until my leg.
I will stand tall, feel Johnson.
All-time.
Johnson.
All-time.
Get one.
Get five.
Get one.
Get five.
Who we?
Horse.
Who we?
Horse.
This is my show.
Oh, oh, oh.
Man, I don't know about you, but when I was 15, I did not look like that. I clearly was a different type of athlete. But what was interesting with this approach is that we heard the voice of the consumer. Because we knew them, we knew that there was no platform on the planet for them to showcase their talent. If you didn't go to the right school, if you weren't being heavily recruited, if you weren't a son of a famous athlete, how did the world discover your ability? So we created this moment called The Open. And at The Open, we allowed students to come in, showcase their talents in what we call 7-on-7, so skill positions in football, so the speed guys, the running backs, the quarterbacks, the wide receivers. We allowed them to come in and show what they can do. We created a moment where we created product just for them based on their opportunity. This was their stage. It was about them. We receded to the background. We tested everything. We had a metric we called Spark that allowed them to show their athletic ability, but also their cognitive ability, because we believed in the whole athlete, not just the physical athlete, but the mental athlete. How do you compete intellectually in the classroom? How do you use strategy and tactics to be the best person possible off the field, not just on the field? And what resulted in that was product that went to market and created unique partnerships with our retail partners. We embedded this concept at retail, something that started in 2010, scaled tremendously. Over a four-year period, that allowed us to create a moment in time where not only did we showcase student talent and graduate over 150 kids into college who never would have had a chance to have a scholarship, we also created momentum in the marketplace for our retailer to see that they knew need to understand the football consumer at its core. It's beyond what happens on Sunday. It's the Monday through Saturday that they need to be with the consumer. And so we saw year over year double-digit growth. So now we control, at the time, 68% market share. We went from having 15% to 68% simply by understanding the consumer and serving them in a new or different way. And then the return. This is about problem solving and problem finding. And you'll see a big fundamental shift in the presentation in a second. So one of the things we did in Jordan Brand is the whole world is looking for the next Michael Jordan. So we figured out, okay, how can we leverage the power of TDA to unleash the Michael Jordan in everyone? So if our competitors are looking for the next Mike, we most certainly should be looking for the next Michael. And so TDA is topological data analytics, right? And what that basically means is that it's machine learning versus massive amounts of data. And what you see in the background is called an iris. So it shows all these intricate data points and the interdependencies between each. And we studied the game of basketball. We wanted to understand, did it evolve? Did it change? Are we missing something because our products weren't as relevant as we thought they should be? They weren't moving at the speed of the body's evolution. They weren't keeping up with what the demands of the athlete were telling us. And so we discovered that basketball has 5 positions, but 13 styles of play. We know the root cause of this is because of the influx of foreign players into the NBA. It's a different sense of timing when you switch from soccer to basketball. It's a different sense of spatial relationships. It's a different sense of muscle reaction. It's a different sense of competitiveness. And the game has evolved, but yet the companies that designed for the game didn't. So what we did is we started to focus on what are these 13 positions and how can we leverage technology to create against these opportunities. As you can see, these are all the unique players in the NBA. So we studied over 15 seasons of basketball. We looked at every single position, every single athlete, and we found these clusters of data. And we started to design to the left because in the upper left-hand corner is where some of the premier athletes were at. And Michael Jordan is completely off this chart, by the way. He's a complete statistical anomaly, not because he was my former boss and friend, but because he's literally a freak of nature. Like mathematically, I studied this man. It's fascinating to see what he can do physically. But what we found in this process is that we had a very unique moment to create what we call an IROI, an innovation return on investment, which was about product differentiation and immersive experiences. We wanted to leverage innovation not only in our products, but in the way that we service and communicate with our community. So what we did is 3 distinct things. We made the invisible visible, we quantified what it meant to be Jordan-esque, and we fueled the pursuit. So we evolved with the game, and we innovated for the athlete. We made the invisible visible. We knew that because these athletes were stronger, bigger, and playing different positions, you could be 6'8", 225 pounds, and be the fastest person on the court. I don't know about you, but if you think of someone at 6'8 and that heavy, you wouldn't assume that they would be quick. But this is what's going on right now in the NBA. So we created products that were designed specifically for that position, specifically for that style of play. And you see it in the Air Jordan 29 I just released in February. And then we modernize the sports marketing process. Signing an athlete is like investing in a new company. You have to do your diligence. You have to understand everything because it is a risk. But there's no quantifiable way to really do that. The phenomenon of Moneyball takes into account certain things, but they use if-then statements, which has a huge amount of human biases. TDA eliminates human biases, and it gets down to the interdependency, so it allows us to really quantify what it means to be Jordan-esque and sign the right athletes. The last piece is fuel the pursuit, delivering premium digital experiences, making sure that when we show up in the marketplace, our consumers can take part in the brand in a new way, telling the stories that are relevant for them through the data and the research. This showed up at All-Star Weekend in New York, where you had a room that allowed each person to recreate a moment from MJ's career. And so it was a room full of LED screens, and every single thing was interactive. And each person can relive that moment that they had in their driveway as a child, where they said, 3, 2, 1, game-winning jump shot. But in this instance, they actually were recreating Michael's history. So in short, this is all about problem finding versus problem solving. The leaders of tomorrow will be charged with finding better problems to solve, and design can help you do that. With that, I say thank you.